Hey, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out. I'm going to step over into the center here in our fancy wall. I hope everybody digs the setup. I'm Jason from Lux Lighting. Good morning. Wow, not enough caffeine, I know. Sorry about the coffee. But we're doing something about it still, so you guys can step up. But I hope you guys enjoy the mimosas so far. No, not enough noise for that. Yeah? I hope you guys enjoy the mimosas so far. Okay, we'll try again later. Anyhow, Richard, thank you so much from Illo Lighting, Samson Stages. Okay.
Everything you see here is for rent. If anybody needs anything, let me know before you go.
Cool. So really quick, if you guys don't know Lux Lighting or want to know more about us, I'm the guy to see, or anybody with a blue shirt with a big chicken in the back. Okay. Hope you dig it. And we are rentals, we are sales, and we are also repair. We are also located at Industry City. Today is Cine Gear Weekend, the last day of Cine Gear Weekend, so we wanted to do something special. So thank you, Gaffers Salon, for letting us host this this awesome brunch and putting together this talk for us. Without further ado, I want to get the presentation started, but there's one huge thing that we want to make sure that we say is that we are like almost 10 blocks away from the Cine Gear show. So it is a walk. So after this, we encourage you guys to go and check out the show. Secondly, we have an awesome speakeasy event. If you guys visit the Cream Source booth, just you'll see a little QR code, super special secret. But if you guys can go into that, that's another experience that we're also hosting. So hope to see y'all there. And yeah, Rich, do you?
Want to ask for mute phones? If you wouldn't mind muting your phone for this event so we're not disturbed, and have a good show. Thank you.
Lastly, we have a bunch of other events coming up as well. So if you guys follow Lux Lighting on social media, please. You know, we're and Illo and Samson, thank you so much. Enjoy the presentation. This is John Roche, our moderator, captain of all things Gaffer Salon. Thank you. All right, enjoy.
Check, check, okay. Hey, everybody. Welcome, welcome. Thanks so much for coming. My name's John Roche. A couple years ago, I started this thing called Gaffer Salon, a Facebook group. Really, it came out of Cinematography Salon that David Krupa started, and I just wanted a place where gaffers could chat about lighting and talk shop and exchange ideas, and now there's, I don't know, 4,200 members, literally from all over the world. I think our fifth biggest city is Mumbai, India. So that, along with ICLS, the International Cinema Lighting Society, I mean, these are groups and communities that I can only dream of when I was a young, you know, up-and-coming electric. So anyway, welcome. Obviously, our topic today is the art and craft of reflected lighting. And personally, for me, I don't even think we'd be having this conversation if it wasn't for Christian Berger. At least for me personally, discovering, you know, doing one of those deep drunken dives on the internet one night and discovering CRLS and discovering reflective lighting and thinking about, wait, what is this? And then reaching out to Jakob Ballinger, getting a demo kit finally. Nobody knew what these things were. But I'll tell you, the minute I got these things in my hand, I was like, this is a game-changing product. And it's not even a game-changing product. It so revolutionized my thinking about looking at lighting and understanding how lighting works. It really became this epic journey for me. And so I want to introduce the panel to sort of dive in. And we have a range of shows from Jakob's smaller Hungarian feature up to a big Apple TV show that Justyn and Ted did. And Manuel, of course, working on Gilded Age and Jessica Jones. So Jakob Ballinger, obviously CEO of the Lightbridge. Jakob was Christian Berger's gaffer. They did many, many films together. Ted and I grew up in New York City together in the 90s. Ted, Lehane, Key Grip. Justyn T. Davis, gaffer. The two of these were cohorts, compatriots on Apple TV's show, Dear Edward. And Manuel Billeter, DP, Jessica Jones, and frankly, one of my favorite shows, HBO's Gilded Age, which has just got renewed, which I'm very happy about because my wife is directing and my wife has got a chance to work with Manuel and hopefully again this coming season. So if we could go back to the art slides, would be great. So as you guys were coming in, we were playing these reference, art reference, lighting reference slides. So a lot of these slides, Justyn and Ted were sending back to each other, looking at Edward Hopper, looking at Sargent, looking at a variety of painters. This one here is something Hammershøi that Christian Berger and Jakob would often look at. And Hammershøi is really interesting. I'm gonna let Jakob talk about it in a little bit more in depth, but it was the idea of looking how light is coming into a room and bouncing off all these surfaces. And one thing Justyn had been talking about during the pandemic was just staying at home and photographing the window in his apartment and looking day to day from sunlight to overcast, looking at how light comes into the room and behaves. So if we could switch now to Manuel's light studies. Manuel texted me the other day and he said, I got this interesting light study I wanna talk about. So we wanna show this and I'm gonna hand it over to Manuel Billeter to lead us into the series of photos. So we could step through these or cycle through these.
No, this is good, this is good.
Oh, just, okay, let's just start with this. Just call for the next
let's
slide.
Just start with this because it's a little washed out. I mean, it was taken on an iPhone. So, you know, that's in my go-to Instagram tool. And it's a little bit washed out. Maybe it's just because there's all this ambient light in here, or maybe just because the quantum.
Hey, Tim, can we take down
no, but that's okay, that's okay. But you can see that it's got two colors in it. It's kind of like the like a vertical Ukrainian flag, right? And I woke up, I mean, it was taken when I was in quarantine during a recent COVID bout, and I was in the garden apartment, and I woke up and I saw this pattern on the wall. Maybe you can go do the next picture. Oh, this gives it away already. That gives it away. I saw that there was this light coming in through the window, and so I got a little curious, like what creates this pattern of colors. Maybe we should look at the next. I was just really fascinated. I mean, you always, as a cinematographer, I think, or as a gaffer, or as a filmmaker in general, would say you always kind of observe daily light occurrences. You know, whether it be you sitting at a cafe and you have like the reflected sunlight from passing cars, from the windshields coming in, and it's just there's many different inspirations that you can see every day. And so I was just looking at that, and also like how how the color, the bottom is very pale and bluish, and the top is much warmer, and you can actually see here. I don't know if people on the sides can actually see it. There's free seats right here. How it's warm here, and it's very cool down here. It's just a very simple thing, but super simple. And then I tried to see what caused this. I mean, I had my ideas, but then there's the next slide. And that's what created that pattern on the wall. Basically, that window is kind of like a pinhole camera, so it obviously it inverses the because the blue light is coming, and it's indirect light, as you can see there. It's reflected light from the sky and reflected light from the facade, from the brownstones across the street.
But actually, it isn't that simple. It's actually super complex when you reduce it to something so simple like looking out the window. And isn't that, I mean, when we're trying to recreate things, we think, oh, we put a white, we do an eyebrow. But it just kills everything that gives it the complexity and the painterly quality that you saw, no?
Yeah, no, and it was just, there was zero manipulation in it. It was all natural, all, no interference. And it's kind of funny because when I shared it with a bunch of people, they said, it's incredible how natural light looks completely artificial sometimes. It's kind of like it's just a bit counterintuitive. And I took another one this morning. I took another one this morning because you just always do it. I'll just show here. Okay. Do you see the colors? Do you see there's a red, white, and blue something, right? And there's like, okay, what's this? What's this? What's creating this?
Yeah, it's the red, right?
Again, it's the sky, it's a white window or a white door or whatever it is, and the red facade from across. So it's I find it fascinating how you know, how simple and how artist, how you can find art in life, and how it's just there.
Yeah, I would say that before Dear Edward, I wouldn't once we started using the Lightbridge, I wouldn't really think about as much the color and the quality of light bouncing off of buildings. But once we started going there, now every time I do, when we're building sets, I'm like, what's the building across the street? Because that's going to affect the color that we're going to put on it and how we're what kind of bounce we're going to use.
And it doesn't even matter time of day, because it's going to change throughout the day, right? And then you also start thinking about, when you're talking to art department, what colors they're using, because that's also going to be a reflective surface too. So it's like, it goes so much deeper when you start viewing the world as a lighting surface, right?
Because one of the sets that we had, or one of the locations we had, was in Harlem, and there was, across the street of the from our hero house, was an entire wall of limestone. Like, there was basically an entire block of limestone buildings. And so that quality of bounce that came in every day was so great and so amazing. And, you know, and there's no way you could try to bring in anything that big. So we just steered into it.
Yeah, and, you know, Manuel can tell you as well, it's like, you know, when you're on a stage, it's inverse square law. You can't get something that far away. The reason why that even works is because of the distance and the size, right? So you have to, like, start thinking about how you can kind of replicate those images in a small space sometime, right? It starts to become the science of it all, right?
It's about where you start to look, right? You start to look differently when you start to look for that. It's like just the excitement of finding something, and this feeling, this excitement comes back, because there's new stuff out there we can see and we can find. And I think that's great why you did this talk today, because I think that's exactly what it's about, rediscovering what we're trained to look at through our standard gear to find new stuff. No?
Well, you know, I found it interesting over the last, I mean, we had, to me, speaking personally, I think there was this revolution in reflected lighting that came out of the Lightbridge and CRLS. But I think what I've seen happening the last couple of years is everybody is saying, you know, we don't want a white ultra bounce anymore. We have these other options. We have, like, I forget the fellow's name in Brazil,
Bluff
Bounce. And we have people like John Tyndale in LA with his whole Broca lighting system and breaking up these colors. And I remember years ago doing a feature where the DP wanted the foam core painted the same color as the walls or whatever the set was like, so he could bring in a piece of, like, brown, whatever, or pink, or whatever the wall color was. So I wanted to move into talking a little bit about this idea when you guys, when the project first lands in your lap and you're thinking in pre-pro, you're looking at these art references, you guys are trading this back. I'd like to start with Dear Edward, because you guys were given a very specific challenge from the showrunner. So maybe you guys could dive into thinking about how you're going to approach that project.
I mean, you know, I would ask someone like Manuel, what is real to you, right? Like, trying to understand and process the reality of that, the person who's lensing this show, right? You know, trying to understand what this quality we're trying to create first.
But I also think it was, we were told that we couldn't, because they wanted to shoot through cameras and they wanted to shoot quickly, we couldn't put any lights inside the set or inside of when we were shooting on a location. So for any of it. And so we had to figure out, he had to figure out, and then he came to me with his challenges about how to start moving that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and we were butt on while we were on other shows. So we were actually in production of another show, so I was able to demo a lot of these techniques on the show that I was on at the time. So we had, like, a Slack channel that we started, or a Slack conversation that we started, and I was just sending images of me bouncing lights off of, like, metal grates, right? Lighting a full scene with, like, you know, a garage door, right? And showing how that quality of light was processing. You know, then Teddy was like, oh, yeah, we can do that. He had a couple of units or rags that he had from a truck package that he acquired.
Yeah, so I acquired most of my beginning gear from my old boss, Bob Andres. And we had had these, what I call vintage Matthews equipment, which were these checkerboard LeMays that had a substrate behind them. We affectionately called them microwave because when they, you could feel the heat off them from quite a distance away. But they were great for day exteriors. But then we started using them on the set too. But I, let me just go back one little bit, which is, so Justyn and I had never worked together, and both of us are working other jobs, and you know, I was in the middle of a show that had a lot of stuff going on.
And then you tell a gaffer you can't light a major TV show.
Right. So he starts talking about reflective surfaces and everything. So again, as John had said, I'd worked with John a long time ago. I knew he was talking about CRLS. We had talked about trying to see it, and I had wanted to like get my hands on it, but I hadn't been able to get a chance to use it. So when he starts talking about reflective surfaces, I said, well, you know what? I know that there's this system out there. I'd love to try it. Let's get it for the pilot. And that's what we did, and we started playing with it. And once you start doing that, but you can talk more about your whole.
Hey, Ted, let me play a trailer, a clip from from the show. So, can we? Do you want to see the garage scene first or the group hug scene?
Whichever one you guys want to start with.
Let's start with the garage scene. Clip. I mean, garage scene clip, please.
It just looks gorgeous.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a bunch of skybound, like, you know, we do eyebrows that kind of, like, produce some kind of ambience, but, you know, pretty much everything is...
Well, outside of the side window, which would be in the next shot, we do have the 12-by checkerboard hanging, and that's giving you the warmth that you're seeing through that window.
But it's still indirect. It's a secondary bounce from a mirror that we have rigged above the windows. But it, you know, the thing about it is, even though this is a soft light source, it looks so hard because it's you're looking at the, you know, diversity of darkness. So everything starts to look hard to your eye. I haven't seen this in a while.
The direct light at the kid in the front when the light comes in, what was that from?
A bounce of a light source that was probably hitting a set wall. I mean, I don't even think it was directed at the set. I think it was on, and then we just said stop, leave it.
Oh, that was actually, it was a wall that had been moved, and we just spun it around. It shouldn't have been there, but we used it.
Yeah, and it just blew the background up enough, and when we saw the rehearsal, we were like, yeah, that's it. The only thing that we intentionally lit was those windows.
And the giveaway is always the eyes, right? If you light it correctly, the eyes pop, and it's not 10,000 sources in there as well.
I mean, the one thing that we did learn about this space was, like, a darker day was a 4K and a brighter day was a 9K. That's the only thing about, like, bounce lights is that you need more photons overall.
Can you repeat that? What did you say?
We went from a M40 to a M90 on brighter days. So this is a darker day, so this is an M40.
Can we cue up the next clip, which is called a group hug?
This scene is, you know, we would have 18Ks, but this one here is probably, you know, soft silvers instead of hard silvers. And then we did a lot of color shifts in camera, like instead of to get our cool instead of gelling.
So to be clear, this is a set. This is a
built set. Yes, this is a set. Okay.
Yeah, this is not location.
And so on the far wall, across from her, again, we used an 8x of that microwave.
This is cool.
As passive. There was no direct light in it, but it did sort of lift up and just fill in.
Well, the thing about it was on the opposite end of the room, kind of behind Connie's head. So it kind of, so that warm light is that bounce, right, from the dimes that we call it. But it became a bigger light source when it got to Taylor because it was that far away. So it just looks like no light. But again, lighting a full circle of skin tones in the same room and not changing the light source is, you know, the proving that this is a great element.
Can you talk about the basic lighting setups? You had an 18K, you had some big guns outside pushing.
There's a picture if you want to pull it up. You can see exactly how we did it. It's 18Ks on a truss.
I didn't get that picture.
Yeah. So there were 18Ks on a truss. There were also 18Ks down below. There was like a well that was just outside the window, and we had lights below there, bouncing up into an eyebrow that was just above
a muslin. So outside that window is all 18K shooting straight up. And then we used to cut the windows, but we liked how it raked it to kind of create that like softness, the haziness of it, and then we started putting like trees to create, you know, more reality. But we also studied these locations too, right? Like we would go to that practical location to see when the sun was where.
Not this room, because this room didn't exist.
Yeah.
But we would be at the location and know, okay,
this is
where it would be, and so this is what it should be like.
But you also have to think about it because it's a basement, so it's not like it would be a steeper light source always.
Guys, just insert for the lights live stream. They bring up the lights.
Oh, yeah, please. Tim, could you bring the lights up, please?
I think it's really interesting and also very important what you guys mentioned about never lighting the room the same, which is especially challenging when you shoot in a studio where kind of stuff is rigged in one way, and then you expect or production expects, well, all you do is you flick on the switch and we're lit, right? Yeah, but it's lit every time. It's the same thing. So it starts looking over the course of a season. It starts looking very, very artificial and just fake. And I think that if you start lighting the room according to the necessities of the scene. I mean, every scene is a bit different, and you should capture the authenticity or the emotional crux of the scene, and then find the appropriate lighting for it.
Because
and
technically, if you look at it, most of this is
can we actually freeze frame it there where we see the whole.
Of that would be considered bad lighting because there's so much hard light hitting someone's face if you like locked in on some of these faces. But that's the diversity, right? Some people are getting hard light, some people are getting. If we pause it here, guys, whoever's.
Yeah.
It's just some people are getting hard light, some people are getting soft light, some people who would look muddy in an independent image, right? Like, it's just all of that array.
No, and it's also it feels so natural. It feels real, you know. So it gives it. You're able to emotionally access this scene if it feels real like this, right? But the bright light right underneath the windows, the floors, shiny floors, is kind of bouncing back into the room. So basically, that's what, you know, kind of lighting the room, and then the room will help you light the actors as well. And there's some hard, a little hard light on the side there. I mean, there's just a lot going on, and it's very complex in details. But it looks great. It looks absolutely great. I mean, it looks like it's a real location.
See, and that's the thing, right? Because you say it's complex, but at the same time, there's such purity to it. And because if you look at the floor, there's no lights in the room. You would see everything in the floor.
Yeah.
And that clarity and still the complexity there gives it that, what you were saying, so right, that emotional power, right?
So I just want to, I do have to make a comment about the floor, which is Justyn went to them and said, you have to buff the floor. Every time it was like, I want it shinier. No, shinier. And so you got this. But this helps so much with the overall of the image because you've got these little specular highlights in lower ground, and so it allows for a depth of what's going on. And that, again, is that's reflected light, right?
Okay, and it helps you carve out the shapes and carve out the actors as well. I mean, I remember when painting sets, I've also asked, make it really. Can you please use really shiny paint so I don't need a lot of light, so I can just like a little bit of a bounce hitting that wall at the right angle. It'll create, an area of brightness, you know, and actors can be in front of it and silhouetted, and they don't, you know, and there's some separation. So I mean, the materials, the textures of what we're photographing, is super important with this sort of approach.
I would also point out the wall in the background, this wood wall, which would normally, one, the fact that was scenics, right? They all of that, but it looks so lived in. And two, we did have so much of, you know, these multi-hued individuals and making sure that everyone is stands out and taken care of in these spaces. And a lot of times what we just do is throw up a kick. I'd do like a kick off the floor, but I'd use some light bridge just to kick out so that we've got a little separation on the wall.
And those pools do so much. Like, when you're thinking about not using light sources, you still have to think about ambience, right? So you start thinking about interesting ways to kind of reestablish ambience. So hitting the floor in a certain place lifts the room, right? Hitting the ceiling now with some kind of bounce source lifts the room. So you're doing the same thing, it's just not inside anymore, right? Like you're just thinking about how you do what you've learned, where we call it a LECO or whatever the gear that we would say, hits the ceiling to create ambience, you just start doing it from outside. And it creates these interesting tableaus and moments when people cross them because it looks like dappleage. It looks like something real because that's just natural, right? That refraction of light when you are in a lived space.
I mean, it's the thing is, when I started working with Christian, right? If you look at over here where the coffee machine is, that was working, is that you can see exactly the windows in there. When I started to work with Christian, we had set up a lights, and he looked in the glasses, and he was counting the amount of reflections in the glass on the table and said, "There, we've got three windows, there's four reflections. You got to kill one." I was like, what's that guy doing? You know, we have to light faces and not look at the glasses. But by reducing it to that point where there's such purity there, and that's when it suddenly hit me. It's like, you know, what's the biggest emotional impact we as image creators or lighting people can do is the gap between two things, right? That's where the most emotional impact is because that's our mind putting it in there. It's like between a comic, right? The gutter, right? That's where we create our own impact, our own emotional impact. So the more we can reduce this and let the emotion flow for the people that are watching it, the better it is. And that doesn't happen by overlighting. That happens by being hyper precise and by reducing it, like the white, like the bright space back there and the dark in the front. It makes it so much stronger.
But it's, well, Justyn, you were saying something.
We were always focused on like zones, like always having a 10. You know, like I do it for selfish reasons because I don't like the editor or the post people boosting it. So I always put something in 10 in the middle of the frame. So there and there, or around 9 or 10, just so that the highlights can't go brighter.
You made a comment about the idea, if you could talk about just, I don't know if saying embracing the imperfections, but and Ted, you were talking, you know, about dissonance. Maybe you guys could talk a little bit about that idea and concept.
I'm sorry, one more time.
The idea of imperfections.
Oh, I mean, that's the quality of life, right? I mean, you know, not to get so cerebral in this moment, but I mean, I feel like that's what we really understand is the difference in what we see. Like if we look around and look at everyone now, and, you know, it may be artificial, but maybe not, right? Like you still see someone in the back that's not lit, but you know, you're not saying that it's dark back there, right? You just know that that's in this environment is very realistic, right? So I think, you know, getting so caught up in saying that someone's in the dark or someone's dark is, you know, it all depends on your intention, right? Like Manuel is saying, it's like that white wall allows me to say that he isn't dark, right? Because he's sitting in front of something white. Or like, you know, seeing someone sitting in front of a black wall, then maybe we have a conversation about what outfit we put that person in, right? So it's like the ways you play with this understanding of light and dark, where it's not just about luminance, right? Because, you know, we can get so lost in that and then it becomes a gear conversation again, right? Then you're not having the processing of, you know, what we're doing, right? Or how we're creating or how this world exists and, you know, this space that we can kind of start to play with and it becomes an art form then, right?
In terms of dissonance and what I meant about it is, so dissonance, I don't know how familiar you are with music theory, but there's, in a chord structure, there are times when you have tones and then it starts to get to sort of atonal. It starts to get, there's tension in these sounds that are slightly unpleasant and then it moves towards a resolve. And sometimes, especially when we're working with three cameras and they're on circular dolly track, you know what I mean? Like there's gonna be times when it's not gonna be the way we want it to. And we just had to sort of like let go of the idea that every second of that thing is gonna be perfect and know that what we planned for was, yeah, there's a feeling of like, oh, maybe it's not, you know, and the professionals are gonna say, oh, that was off. Other people aren't gonna necessarily feel that. But for me, as long as you end up in the tableau that you wanted to end up in, where you finish with something that is how you wanted it to end up, then that movement all the way through that completely works, and they only remember the end.
And the actors usually resolved it, right? Like they would fall in the best light because psychologically our mind just wants to be safe, right? You know, it's like the reason why we find these places of comfort, or whether we sit in a, you know, the dark or in the light, is because it's whatever psychologically. And actors, and especially because we call ourselves a theater company, we're using those as motivators. So it's interesting how, you know, they just find a resolve in that dissonance.
I really like the reference or the comparison to music that Ted just said, because I always see kind of like filmmaking or cinematography as a very musical process. I mean, it's kind of like a symphony where, you know, everything has to play together. And yes, sometimes in dissonance as well. You know, the chords that don't make much sense, but that, you know, for dramatic purposes, that can totally work. But I think if you start thinking like you know, like a question and answer interplay between many, many different instruments or ingredients or you know, whatever you want to call it. It's in the totality. It's in the time continuum that it really gets incredibly exciting. You know, to see how everything works together. Like, you know, I don't know. I mean, that's also why Bounce Lights is so interesting. Also fascinating because it's an interplay between two elements. I mean, you know, one being the light source and one being the material that it bounces into it. So that's why I mean, there's an infinite amount of possibilities in a way between different you know, bounce, or you know, created by bounce light. So I mean, I know with Lightbridge having like four or five different surfaces now, then you can, you know, combine them with different lights. It can be a soft light, can be a hard light, can be just. It's really fascinating. I think just like it's challenging to actually start conducting the light in a way with these tools and also with what a production designer, what the art department actually put, the costume designer puts in front of you that you can play with, you know, like a light bouncing off of a red shirt, you know, like a close up. You know, somebody goes in for a hug and the other person is wearing something red. It's super dramatic, you know, and it's you didn't do it. It's really the costume designer's contribution at that point. So it's like this, you know, this musical symphony, this orchestra that always works together and collaborates. And I think that's like bouncing light is yet another element that can create something unexpected sometimes.
And just jumping off of Miguel, is that it's you start to kind of really see the physics of it all, right? So like if the resolve of this entire scene was just to create soft light, right? Now you start to think about where's your first bounce source, right? Is it muslin? Is it, you know, poly? Is it, you know, a soft silver? And then if you just keep the physics of soft light from the beginning, you know, by the time you get there, it's a breath, right? You kind of start to create this very airy feeling in the room. And then you have to think again, what's the next thing that I want? Is it hard? And you start to think of, what do I want hard? So you have to, and it's all physics, right? It's like, now I'm going to bounce the floor or the something that absorbs light more. So it's like, it really has to start at the beginning. And when you're starting to process it all, at the symphony that we're calling it, you know, you're really conducting it from the beginning.
Where does that come in? Like, you know, from the point of pre-pro, when you're talking about the look, you're doing the scout. Is the scout where you really start to nail that down, and then the finishing touches happen when you're shooting, or how are you thinking about getting to that point?
I think we know, we kind of found it block one, we were kind of discovering it. You know, I guess the producers loved the way that, you know, because they wanted to shoot on the stage just to see if this even worked. And then they fell in love with it, and then I think we just kept getting better at it. But it's not easy. Like, I mean, you know, if you're used to I'm not going to say clumsy because that's a subjective way, but like, if you're used to the traditional way of lighting, actors are going to be like, are we ready? Right? You know.
Yeah, because we just would, the other thing that we would do is, we called it the bag of tricks, and so there was pieces of Luan that we had different, all different kinds of reflective material, gold, regular mylar, black mylar. Some were actually checkerboard of everything, and we'd throw them down. If we needed an extra push just down farther, I knew it was below camera, we'd throw them down, and you know, the actors were like, can we walk it out? I'm like, yep, sure. And that was almost the only thing for most of it. And at the end, you know, when we would go in for close-ups, you know, in terms of how I was using this light bridge, I would look around, and most of the time I would be leaning into whatever the practicals that were in the space were, and I would just pull out one of the smaller ones if I needed to get a little bit of eye light or something, just for that last bit, if we went for the emotional close-up. But
it came more about set dressing, because I know the first block we were actually lighting, like we would have like a Leco kind of bouncing into a CRLS and our Joker, yeah. But then we just stopped lighting and it just became more about like art direction.
Yeah. Like one thing I want to touch on that I know, man, I'm like the one person who's actually worked with every, like all these guys. So, one thing that I really was want to talk to Manuel about is, you know, what I call diegetic bounces, which is like what he's saying is when an actor has a red outfit, and then we see that reflection. So if you know what's reflected because you see it in the image, I call that a diegetic bounce, just like diegetic music. So we had worked on a show that was a lot of procedurals, and a lot of times I feel like we often would use paperwork, right, to sort of help.
Oh yeah, paper. The paper bounce, of course. It's amazing. You just put a light up top and it bounces into the paper, and there you go. And in during that moment of discovery by reading this paper, the face gets illuminated. It's like a light bulb is going on, right?
Right.
So it's amazing.
Right.
It never fails.
Exactly.
I was gonna show move to showing one of Jakob's clips. If we can cue up what do we call it? The restaurant scene. So this is, I'll let Jakob talk about it, but this is from a film called The Grand Cahier that Christian Berger shot. Jakob was the gaffer.
Wow.
Not to talk over you, Jakob, but I think the thing that I really love about this is that this really abusive light source that they're just walking through casually. Like, it's so clean looking. And, you know, I don't know if this is driving the scene. Is this your ambient? Is this all you guys have?
Yeah, so I started to fall in love with, actually, and I'm not sure about the English term, but you see how thick the wall is from the window coming in? And that just became the primary light source. And we shot actually completely at nighttime. So we had to kind of build it from zero. So we did like eyebrows too on the top. And then we used the reflectors actually just to bunch into the thickness of the wall basically. So what the guy's getting is just coming off the wall there and a little bit something from it. And it's, for me, it's always the balancing of the fill light in the room, which is being made by secondary light sources, like the floors, like the walls. So there's nothing in the set because it would just ruin everything, you know? You look into the eyes and it just doesn't match anymore. And then for those little hard spells coming through, I did think we have a little bit of push coming in directly at that end. But that's the reason, you know, you have to be able to look outside. In this case, you're looking at black duvetine. yeah, but that's the way it works. And you see it in the eyes, it's just clean. And then maybe we had to add, it's something on the table, there's something to add into there. But the further the light travels, the more natural it looks. And that's not only about the primary light source, it's also about when it starts to hit off the secondary light sources. So what you're calling it diegetic, I always called it like the DNA of light. It's always picking up something from the next and it's adding on to it. And that's the reason you just can walk through the light because it's always in the right relationship with what was going on, yeah. That was a tough movie to shoot. Man, I haven't seen it in a long time.
This is what, 2013, I think.
Yeah.
Shooting a day scene at night, there's some cruelty behind that concept.
Yeah, especially with kids, but nobody cared in Hungary.
This just looks like a Van Gogh. I mean, it's probably totally yellow, but you know the just the connotations that come up. It's there's a stillness, and yet it's so dramatic, especially when they walk into the hot light source, which is just on the costumes primarily. It's I love when there's within a scene when there's a progression when there's a change happening, people walking in and out of lights, and sometimes you see them, sometimes you don't, and also it creates this palette of what Justyn was talking earlier about. I always want a 10 somewhere, so you have all the notes from 0 to 10 or from 0 to 100, and you have the highlights, but you also have the darkness. You have all these different zones within one frame. So it just becomes very dramatic, and just, you know, I don't know, just there's a diversity in it that I always find
Can you bring up the lights?
Inspiring.
For the internet, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, and the thing was, right, I mean, that was like a really, really small production. Like, it was me plus three guys. That was it. Yeah, that was it. But the thing is, it just works because you use everything that you can, and you're not forcing anything against it. So I think it was like 3 1.2Ks, or no, it was 4. It was one in the opposite part of the room, and then it was just 3 big reflectors, plus the biggest work was actually putting up the eyebrow on the top for that room, and that was it. Then we could pre-light it because we're shooting somewhere else, so I had 2 guys down there, 1 person with me on the set, and then we moved down and shot it. Yeah. So it's not just, you know, the thing is, it's not about the amount of gear you use. It's just what you're using, you have to use just so precisely to make it work. Mm. Then you have time actually to play with it. That's the thing, right? If it's me plus 3 and you've got 15 lights up, you're not touching all the lights anymore.
It just feels so poetic, especially when you see these dark faces. Like, I don't feel uncomfortable by any of this. It's actually, it makes me feel more emotion.
Yeah, it's just the bounce off the wall. It's just, you just let the room live.
But for me also, the starkness of all this, like, obviously it's uncomfortable for the kids coming in the room and everyone staring at them. So, like, early on, you've got really, you know, like, really contrasty playing out. And I like that you don't see some people. Some people are like, hidden in the corner, because it makes it more of a mystery. It makes it more of, but even there, like, I love that sort of real contrasty. 50-50.
Yeah, the yellow walls and the dusty, you know, props is like everything for this scene for me.
Yeah. And you embrace it, right? It's not like, oh my God, there's something yellow coming off the wall. What's going to happen with the faces? You let it live within that.
And that was a practical location. Or did they art that?
Oh, we didn't have no money for that stuff.
Oh my God.
That was
so good.
Yeah, that was, oh man, it was such a, it was in Eastern Germany. We moved from Hungary to Eastern Germany at some point, yeah.
I gotta say, you really need to watch this whole film. Yeah. It is so gorgeous.
So you say you found that location as is? See, that's the great thing also about location work. And when we were talking about the challenges of like studio work versus location work, I mean, locations, a great location is a great storyteller. You just have to find the location that really becomes a character of the story and is in the support of the narrative. And I mean, that's incredible that was available, because it gives it so much texture and so much subtext, and you just start reading between the lines a lot. It just becomes I don't know, the space. You can't get rid of spaces in filmmaking, and so the space really needs to tell the story and propel it forward and create this time space continuum that we respond to emotionally or psychologically or cerebrally or all of it.
Sorry, was this always meant to be shot at night, or that was thrown on you kind of last minute? You went late, and then you had to move into this scene.
Of course. You know, that's the thing. If you choose the gear in the right relationship with the crew you have, then it starts to all fall into place, and you can have fun with it. Because, yeah.
But you know, not even getting too deep into it. It's like, I'm just going to ask. It's the feeling, right? Like, you feel it after a point, right? Like, you were in this movie for how many days at that point?
It was the last leg of the movie, and we had 28 days to shoot it.
Yeah.
And it was day 25 or something.
It's just like a rhythm. Like, it's so...
But that's like with every job, right? You start to get into it, and you start to feel what it needs and what's possible.
Can we freeze it for a second? On the reverse, yeah, that. The one thing I appreciate is, with that size crew, you didn't have anything big outside that window, right?
There was three 1.2 Ks, that was it.
Right. So, and what I like is that there's not this fear of we need to put white out there because it's gotta be day, right? It's just, let it be what it's gonna be and let the light come in. And the windows are a little dirty and they got a schmutz, and so they're gonna conceal it a little. But, you know, if you did have a big white out there, it would have killed a lot of the value, and it would have felt really even outside that window.
Yeah, that's always the thing with the initial approach. It's blow out the windows, right? But I think that's the really wrong thing to do. But that's something I really learned from Christian, because he was always saying, I will look out of every window. I say, Christian, it's night. I can't light the that out there. I can't do it. So I say, just put a black. Let's make the windows dirty. Off we go. Yeah.
Do you remember what you had? It's been 10 years, so you probably don't remember. You had a couple CRLS, and you said a couple 1.2s or something?
It's always the same. It's like the light's on the floor. It's going up. You've got an eyebrow, which was ultra bounce and some kind of white. Now, we had a lot of bleached muslin. It was bleached muslin, and then the reflectors were underneath the bleached. So we're using the spill from the light source in the white, and then we were adding into the push, and the push was always going into the wall, basically. But there were 2 points when it came in directly. But that's when you start to use the 50s, and you just start to push into it.
It's kind of what that snap bridge over there does, right?
Yeah.
If it would have had a bit.
That's a portable one where you have the soft bounce and the precision, more channeled light. You know, you got two for one with that, or with that eyebrow system with the reflectors.
It's what you were saying earlier was so nice, is about as soon as you bounce, you already start to, there's a certain harmony starting. Light source, boom, bounce, boom, it goes away. And this quality of layered lighting to say you got soft, you got something hard in it, that's where the complexity comes in. And that's the reason it's fun watching it, because there's always something challenging us not to get used to. It's getting dark, we get used to it, it gets bright, we gotta get used to it. And that, I think that's what keeps the scene alive. And we're just so afraid of having to always see the faces and not feel the faces.
Right? And this is, for me, the imperfection that allows this to really stand out, right? Like, you know, as a traditionalist, we would say the faces are too dark, or in a Hollywood perspective, you know, this is just, man.
Yeah, I mean, yes, you could say, well, it's not balanced enough, there's not enough fit, but I think that the way we experience it by watching something like this, it actually forces us to kind of pay attention and to actually look a little deeper and to make a little bit of an effort. And it's just a different sort of experience that we are subjected to when we are looking at images like that, where there are moments that are underexposed. Also, what's really great about this moment is that we saw them just a couple of seconds earlier, very very clearly. You know, so we know them already. So now that we know them already, and I don't know, I didn't see the film, so I don't know if we've seen them before, but having them walking through the light, we make their acquaintance in a way, and then after that, after we know them, there is an emotional attachment, and it's okay to let them go a little darker. And it's not that I can still see the little ping in the eye. There's something there. It's just modulated in a way that it kind of creates this emotional arc, and I think if you just balance everything all the time, it just becomes boring, because it becomes everything is the same every time, you know. So it's
I'd even go one step further and say that, like, in the storytelling,
you always do that.
Oh, I know. but in not being able to see, because we've already invested in them, and not being able to see what's going on with them, this is what I mean by that atonal thing. And like, you get worried, like there's this fear of it. And so then later on, you know, because right after this you cut to the woman and she yells. And the next time we see them, right, he's got them by the scruff of the neck. So there's a lot, you know, all of that, not being able to see them helps get to that moment.
I mean, again, you were telling story, right? So actually, she was a really good friend of them, and then she left to the city, and they were worried she was getting raped or whatever was going on. It's a wartime movie, Second World War, and they go to look for her, and they go in and find her, and she's betraying them, and she's calling thief, thief, thieves. That's the reason they try to grab her. So it's this whole thing that goes with it.
I'm curious if you can talk in pre-pro or before. I mean, did you discuss the tone of this, or it was not that kind of budget, so you made the call in the moment, or how did you arrive at the choices here?
I mean, it all plays off looking at Hammershore, and it's so crazy looking at Manuel's pictures, what he took, you know, with the colors. It's the same kind of thing that's happening down there with the wood pieces that you see in the Hammershores. So that drove it. And what Justyn was saying, we were towards the end of the movie, so there was not a lot of discussion going. We were shooting a different location. Chris and I walked in the morning, knew we were running late, so we say, okay, this is about what the scene has to be. And it's the only scene in the movie where there's actually haze, because Christian usually hates that, but everybody's smoking. So of course it made sense. And then you're already in the flow. And I think that's the best thing that can happen to you in a production, where you don't have to communicate anymore and you're in the flow. But that means you have to have, you have to be able to trust the DP and vice versa to make it work. Because I always hear that too often, like, I see my job as a gaffer to imitate the style of the DP. I'm never going to be as good because I'm imitating something. And so I can prepare it that when the DP comes in, can do the magic touch. And it's just, yeah, that's my job, just trying to imitate as good as I can. So when Christian comes in, we got 15 minutes before all the extras come in. It's already there, but he knows, yeah, it's yeah.
Why don't we shift to talking about the Gilded Age? I believe it's just called Gilded Age Trailer.
How was your day?
Lovely. Thank you, Mrs. Bauer.
And you enjoyed the pie?
Oh, very much.
It's good to spoil yourself now and again.
And that's what I've been doing all day. Spoiling myself.
You're lucky one, Miss Armstrong.
And don't I know
that
it?
That table bounce to me is amazing, by the way.
Oh, yes. It looks lucky.
It's so funny to see those juxtaposed of the two. We're doing small European productions and then...
I can
take
that.
And you will report back to me?
I'll tell you anything I think you should know.
Very well. We will promote Adelheid, and between the two of us, we will manage Miss Gladys.
What's this?
Mrs. Bruce has persuaded me to let Gladys have a lady's maid and not to hire another governess.
Well done, Mrs. Bruce.
Don't I get any praise?
Well done, you.
What's this? You know what it is, a salad fork. We never lay a fork without a knife or a spoon to partner it. Nor is salad a course on its own. It is eaten with the entree or the remove on salad plates which fit the curve of a larger dish. And what is this?
What does it look like, Mr. Bannister?
A spoon for the coffee. No teaspoon is ever laid on an English table. If one is needed, it is supplied at the apposite moment. Mrs. Russell, good day to you.
My maid told me you were here. This is very kind.
I'm pleased to be of assistance.
There are so many snares designed to catch us out.
We have it under control, ma'am.
I'm afraid I've asked too much of you, Church. It wasn't fair of me. Mr. Bannister, for all our sakes, is there any chance I can prevail on you to take charge?
At the luncheon for Mr. McAllister.
Exactly. On Friday the 18th. I would be so grateful.
Ma'am, I'm sure we can manage.
I won't be so cruel as to make you try. What do you say, Mr. Bannister? Would Mrs. Van Ryn ever allow it?
I'm afraid there'd be a problem, madam. I cannot pretend otherwise.
Well, I hope it's a problem that $100 will solve.
$100?
I understand I'm asking a lot.
You could rely on me, madam. Don't give it another thought. In 2 days' time, Mr. Church and I will finalize the setting.
But what position would I occupy? I must be here. Mr. Bannister is not familiar with the house.
You can settle that between you.
I do not quite understand how I am to present this to the staff.
Why not tell them the truth, Church? There are some situations when it really can be helpful.
Bring the lights up, please.
It's a beautiful piece.
Next level.
I mean, so there's, you know, the downstairs, upstairs.
Sorry, Manuel. Can you freeze it as soon as she walks in? Because I think that's the pure genius
Hold on. So, bring it back. Back, right? Back a
it's
little bit?
A little bit back. Because she's getting the light from the table, no? She's coming in.
Right there.
Yeah. That's kind of like a skip bounce from, I think I put it into a CRLS outside that window, and it just kind of bounced into the table. So that's what it was. That's what I mean when sometimes you just light the room, and the room will take care of the actors, or will take care of the character, will take care of the authenticity of the scene, where it feels like it's lit from within, and there's no really, or it doesn't feel like there's exterior or extraneous light sources in there. If you go back a little bit too, those are the things that I go crazy about sometimes. Is that there's light coming in from upstairs at the top of the stairs. Keep going back. If you go back a little bit, if you blink and you miss it. But it's just like a little, the light from upstairs where there is a lot of light, and downstairs there's much less light. It comes in at a much deeper angle. It doesn't really get into the faces of the characters. Whereas in contrast, upstairs it's much more bright, it's much more luminous, it's much more lavish, if you say. But here it's kind of like scattered light. Also, I mean, in the sequence of this episode, she just had a terrible experience at her mother's apartment in a tenement, because in the Gilded Age, we don't really see very much how the other half lives. But so that was an opportunity for me to show, how most people actually lived in New York at the time, and it was much darker. The light barely makes it in through the windows, and this is carried through a little bit here. But it's just like really if you keep playing it, you see just like at the end a close up. It's just a little bit of a bounce, and here this is very silhouetted, and the light is somewhere else. The light is not on the subject.
That's all studio, right?
Huh?
That's
this is the, yeah. This is all. Yeah. This is all at the stage. Yeah. This is all stage. Yeah. And it's just like a little bit of a bounce back from the other window that hits the wall. But yeah, I just wanted to make it feel dark in between the light sources. And here we have, it's much more luminous, much more grand, it's much more soft, and the light really, reaches the characters. This was done with a CRLS, like the big quad that I have
behind the scenes if you want to.
Jakob kindly put together for the show. And the next scene too. I was just using basically the quad that we have some BTS.
Can you put up the BTS for the Gilded Age, please?
Something That's like amazing. That. Yeah. As you can see, it's because the sets are so huge that I thought a big set it can afford having big bounces, big reflectors, and what this was able to give me was really a very directional bounce. You can see telescopes up and down. It's on wheels. The doors are huge. The ceilings are very high. So it's once it's on those two crank elevators, it's just very easy to maneuver it. And also, like if you wanna just change the angle a little bit, it's a very easy task because it just rolls around.
I mean, that's something. Maybe you can talk about that, because in the way I always used the reflectors was to use more harder light sources, and you're the person actually who introduced me to the idea to use like soft diffused panels into the reflectors.
Yeah, and I was mentioning earlier, it's kind of a question and answer. It's like a give and take. I mean, depending on how you hit it first, what kind of response do you get? So knowing that I didn't have to worry too much about spill in this big room, so I was actually kind of help, you know, just bring the vomit. In a way, that's yet another version of the snap bridge over there. If you look at it, it's the bounce back. There's the precision bounce back from the C100s or from the quad, as we started calling it. And then there's some natural bounce back from the art from the set. So it feels very naturalistic.
Are those all the same panels? All number.
Gaffer Sean Sheridan standing next to the camera there. Oliver Carey. Best camera operator in the world.
I just piggybacking off of the soft light bounce. I mean, we did that with mirrors too, and it was like something about the intensifier with sky panels that doesn't really create the punch. And I felt that with a 360 in a mirror, you get like this really sharp LED that you really can't get out of any light, and it's broad. So. Yeah, I agree with Manuel.
You want to step through these BTS? Yeah,
sure. If there's, I've shown them a couple of times before, so I'm sorry if it gets boring. But just for close up work, I would just basically book it. You know, I would just put like a diffusion in between. Sometimes I would put the 12 by in between to begin with. It's a very easy. Simple setup in a way. Yeah.
I just want to say, because it's a close-up, I'm really proud of that I continue my work as a gaffer, not on set, but able to support fellow colleagues and on set, is that we build special stuff for them. So Manuel came to us and says, look, I need a bigger source, what can we do? And we basically made it for them. So this is not a product on the market. Ted and Justyn are now using it too, so we'll see if it comes out. But basically, it's a special custom made. Yeah.
I can't wait to see what it does for Moonlight. That's what I'm more excited about. not to take away from
the... No, I wasn't. No.
Is that, you know, there's something about when you start processing what Moon is, you kind of realize that it is a direct light source. And I can't wait to play with this for some night scenes.
Do you have that one where you had it on a lift and you were basically extending the sunlight?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Let's go to the next slide.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that's actually the setup that we actually saw the result of in the previous clip, where the maid is talking to Bertha Russell at the desk there. So basically, there was just like this one light source in there, and just like I put it as close as possible to the wall, so it would really accentuate the structure and the artwork that is on the wall. You know, scraping it, and there was no top or no nothing. I mean, these products are so precise, and they're really so responsive to just the tilt angle or the pan angle that you just barely need to put any flags. If you even need to put a flag up, it's a very loose one, you know, and it's set up very quickly. Obviously there's a little bit of a bay light up top as well. And
what is that? Is that CRLSs as well?
Or? No, up there. No, I wish. those are just S60s that go into muslin bounce. It's a bounce. It's just going up there. And yeah, we had to put this like a. Coroplast nudes around the S60s because there was they're hard to control sometimes. You know, there's over there it was a bleed back a little bit with direct light even. But this is just a muslin bounce, like a big muslin bounce. Yeah.
Want to go to the next slide?
Oh yeah, no. And this is the classic setup that Jakob was talking about. Just the light underneath and just go into. I think this was like the diff 2. Again, it was. I wanted to get a very steep angle. I wanted I know that Ted hates it too when you can when we can see the parallax when the sunlight is keystoning basically and it's like coming in from two different directions. Yes, I could have put like a one big lift out there, but then it would have gotten the windows in a very different way, and then it would have like spread out like it just naturally it does, and maybe there is a result from inside. Also, I could really kind of like. Pinpoint the light where it would hit the shears from the inside.
It's not like
a big wash that goes all over it, because this is a little bit harder, this diff one here. So it was hitting it right at the top. If you look at the windows, it's just the top part is more lit than the bottom part. And so from inside, it created an effect, again, this effect of light not really getting through or getting inside.
What also happens with these, especially when you start working in lower light values, is that the curtains, because they're skipping it and he's raking it, the curtain gets illuminated and it becomes sort of its own subsource, you know,
yeah.
Which is great. Because that's a big, broad source that we know why it is. We understand it doesn't feel weird. But basically, it's like sort of like the ripple muzz. There's a couple I was talking about before, these other ways. But we did something very similar to this on Madam Secretary, where she had these like golden shears in her office, and we would constantly rake down on them, and that would push in.
Which I just learned yesterday from Jakob that's a traditional Japanese way of lighting. They don't even point lights at people, they just put diffusion in front of them and point the light.
But light the diffusion from another angle. Yeah.
You want to go to the next slide?
Sure.
Not sure how many we have here.
Same. I mean, here the challenge was like a really low ceiling, and bringing in something from outside, and you couldn't put like a lamp pad close enough to the ceiling. It would basically come in at 90 degrees rather than from a little angle from above. So those always help, getting you extra height, and also with the inverse
square law.
It just feels like it's the light source is much further away, and that's also a very good. It's also very helpful, because here if the light would hit those metal grates, those iron grates, they would like really heat up a lot, and then inside it would just fall off very dramatically, and it was just not. It wouldn't look very naturalistic. It wouldn't look realistic.
And just. You know, trying to help explain what he's saying is that because of the mirror or the surface that we're talking about, the light is bigger and the light is further away. So that's all we're doing is creating space from that window so that it feels as if it's at a more acute angle opposed to where the light can actually be.
And it's fall off as it moves into the room. Like, you guys know the inverse square law, right? So the closer you are to the light, it's gonna be brighter, and then the farther away you get, that fall off becomes less and less.
Next slide.
Oh, wait, yeah, here I wanted to get, well, this is the big...
Max arm.
Max arm. I just wanted to get more light or dramatic light while the character was sitting at the desk already. I mean, there was a big 18K outside. That is hitting like the stuff in the background there, and the character will go from the desk to that alcove, and I didn't want him to step into the light. I was really wanted the light on him, throughout the entirety of the scene. So putting a Jolico into a C100, it helped me extend the 18K that was outside, basically. So it felt, so when he got up and walked over to that, where that little bust is, it felt like he was always in the same light, but basically he was going from the C100 seamlessly into the 18K. And, sometimes, sometimes it makes sense to, or you want to create this continuum of light, because, I don't know, I forgot what the scene was about, but just to me it felt like he needed to be hot right at the beginning, and then maybe back there be more silhouetted, but still have the hot side light.
And the cool thing is, because the reflectors are spill light free, you see that the light gets extended where it should be at the desk, but it doesn't go anywhere else. So there's no blacks necessary to cover the soft light and stuff.
Yeah, again, you don't have to cut anywhere near as much once you start using these panels. Which, and speaking as a grip, I appreciate that.
Is there another slide? I don't know if we're done with the...
There's the one, the exterior.
Well, that's the same, just a different angle.
Another slide, next one. Okay.
So. Another different angle now. The Joe Lico is the main character in this in this shot.
But I mean, you know, just I mean the simplicity of this, right? You know, because it's that 3% transmission loss, you're using an 800-watt light to light a large room, right? Like, you know, just thinking about even if that light was bouncing to a B-board or, you know, any kind of other surface, that would not exist, right? Like, I mean, you know, that whole, and you know, now we're using inverse square, that's a lighter thing, it's not a mirror. You know, you're able to get this bigger, broader light source because of the separation between the two. And now it's just like, that light is not, that light would be so narrow on that person's face if it was directly pointed at them. So I think that's the most interesting thing.
Yeah. No, I mean with the CRLS, I was just able to just concentrate the light to where I wanted it rather than going everywhere. Yes, sometimes a bead board does a trick as well because you're not focused on necessarily focusing the light, but you know it's always good to have choices of you know various diffusion and bounces.
Is there another slide? I'm not sure how many there were in here.
Oh, this is the out. Yeah, so we brought it to Troy upstate and put it on a lift, 18K going in early morning. It's just a broad and soft source that you know you can't really bounce from that high, putting a 12 by up there. You know, so this was very helpful.
It just made that light twice the size. I mean, even with a 12 by or 20 by, you still need 3 18Ks to do probably what this is doing right now.
You get the specularity, right? The specular.
Right. Yeah. And also you're getting the color from everything around it, because that's the thing about this system is it's metallic. It's not white. So you're going to get all the color of everything surrounding it that's also going to transmit down. And so it's a much more deeper depth of light.
Keep going on the slide. I don't know.
I'm just looking at this and getting inspired because I'm so used to just bouncing lights into whites and now this.
Yeah, now this is a different angle. This I think it was I had it. I was picking up the sun.
Right. This is what I wanted to talk.
I picked up the sun and basically I shot it into the entrance area there. You can see the gentleman standing there. You know, he's being really filled in. No, this is it. It's kind of like a precision bounce where you just, you know, I mean, it really made a change right underneath that awning, and nowhere else. Yeah. And that was just picking up the sun, just picking up. I mean, at that point, the sun had changed, or we had changed direction in relation to the sun, and instead of shooting a light into it, I just used the natural light, which you know it comes in very handy very often, just to balance exposure if you need to balance or if you want to balance exposure.
And the great thing about that is because they're using the sun, if it goes into a cloud, all of the ratios are the same. So as long as you can ride the stop, it's fine. You're not going to suddenly have a 20K that's filling in the one thing that you wanted to fill in. You know, and that's where I like using what we call the dimes, because it does the same sort of thing where it keeps all the ratios. And the dimes are so bright that you can be pretty far away from it. And we would do it. And sometimes I'd book it. I'd use the sun and I'd put a soft diffusion in front of it. But everything would go in and out of the cloud and it wouldn't matter. We could keep rolling because we didn't, all the ratios stayed the same in relative speaking.
Ted, what was the dimes? Will you explain?
So that was this, what I call a vintage Matthews. Oh. It's a checkerboard. The reason it's called dime is because there's an interior substrate that has all these like small little dime-sized holes. Not holes, but relief. And so it looks like someone glued a bunch of dimes behind a checkerboard lame. And it's like, I have it in an 8x and a 12x. And unfortunately, they don't make them anymore. I tried to talk to them convince them, would they make it? And they're like, no, but here's what we made it out of. So if you can find someone to do it, good luck.
We got another show switching from Gilded Age to Ozark. If we can look at the trailer, and then we have the BTS
yeah,
as well.
It's just a short scene of, yeah.
This is one of my favorite shows.
Bring the lights down, please.
Before you get your panties in a bunch, just listen, okay? We're offering credit now, so you gotta stop your shit.
What shit is that?
The fucking loan shark and shit.
I don't lend money to guys that can get credit. You do your thing, I'll do mine. We can coexist.
No, we can't. This is coming from Marty. You gotta cease and fucking desist. It's fucking dumb anyhow.
That right?
Yeah. Take it up with your daddy if you want. I bet he wouldn't think it's such a shit-hot idea for you to be knocking some guy's teeth out in the restroom when the feds are breathing down our necks. I bet he doesn't even fucking know. Any questions?
No.
Good. Now quit parking in the crippled spot. What you got ain't a disability. Just poor fucking judgment.
She is insane.
Lights up, please.
I just added this clip for it's got something to do with bounce light, but basically just actually taking away light. I mean, I had the good fortune of working on season three on Ozark, and I kind of the there was this mandate that came from the top that basically the actors are never in the sun, because you have to keep it dark, to keep it in sync with a dark mood, with a sense of dread and of lurking threat everywhere, anywhere. So in Atlanta, in Georgia, in July, August, there's a lot of sun and it comes straight down all the time. So what we had was, I mean, if you can see her on her coverage here, that it kind of looks quite unnatural. I mean, in broad daylight, you would never have that much contrast in someone's face. With him, a little bit different as well. But so basically, what we had was, I mean, we had like a lot of money and time was spent.
Bring up the BTS on, for Ozark, please.
On creating negative fill, just like subtracting light as much as we humanly could. Or here, this is another. I got really lucky here. I mean, the scene took place on this motorboat there, and obviously because on the lake, there's no way to actually protect from the sun. You know, you can't put stands up, you can't put anything. You know, it was the terrain. We couldn't bring any cranes or anything there. So let's just get a grip cloud. This is helium filled. Mattress, basically, and this show being Ozark, I put black on one side to not just take the sun out, but to actually create a lot of negative fill as well. And well, you know, I said, look, this is the only thing I can try and do is a cloud like that. If there's a little bit of wind, we're fucked. It won't work. But we were very lucky, and you can see the subjects on the motorboat there. You know, at first it was actually sunny, and so we brought the cloud in, and I'll never forget the sigh of relief that the stand-ins uttered when we brought in the cloud, because there's just a level of comfort, of discomfort that the actors were in the hot sun. Made a big difference. So that's maybe we can talk about, you know, how to make the actors feel while on set, while they're being lit. It's also very important. But here, so it's just basically shooting against the sun and then using this as a huge negative as much as we can. Maybe let's scroll through them.
I loved watching the behind the scenes of this, because everybody who talked about this was like, anytime there's direct sun, we just black that out and use the ambient as our key.
Yeah, but sometimes you would have to go so big that it killed
everything,
all the ambient.
45.
Like here it was fine, they keep going. here was still, but see, I mean, it's kind of magical. How we just suspended in there, and just in this case, it's just really just to take a lot of the skylight away, the ambient away. And I think that the next picture, so this is what we had for the other scene in the parking lot. Big 40 by up there, just dressed with foliage, so if we saw them, the shadow, it wouldn't look unnatural. But once this next one, once this thing goes up, it's really fucking dark. I mean, it's kind of scary dark. You know, it's like, oh, what am I gonna do now? So you know, it 18K into a bounce, just to light the subject. And that's what you could see on Julia earlier so much. Like one side completely black, and the other side lit, just you know, barely lit with this bounce. Obviously, the background super hot, right? So it, you know, to balance it, you have to you know. Put a lot of light into the faces so the background doesn't burn out. Then obviously putting ND grad filters up in the sky also helps a little bit. You know, but just anything to achieve that look, that desired look, that mandated look of Ozark dark. Is there another one?
I just have to give a shout out to Mark Catania, who used to be my Dolly Grip.
Go back. There's Mark Catania, the amazing Dolly Grip, yeah. and the legend. Larry McConkie there in the white shirt with the black cap.
Yeah, Mark, I was good fortunate to work with Mark for 3 seasons on Madam Secretary.
Great Dolly Grip.
But I mean, you know, even though this seems complex, right, I think the one thing that, you know, just looking at this is just think of it as like a 4x4 floppy, right? Like, there's also images in this that I saw where they had like a flop on one side, where it was a 4x5 and it came down. So it's like, it's the same principles. It might sound overwhelming because we say 40 by, we say 60 by, but it's the same principles. Like when you're outside in the sun, you have a floppy, it's the same thing.
So I'd like to open it up to a little bit of Q&A or comments, you know, just continue to the discussion. If anybody, do we have a mic that we could send around? Yeah, we could pass. I think they told me they had.
How's this one?
So, anybody thoughts, comments, questions?
How'd you feel? Anything you see?
I got one. Yeah. Right here.
Oh, wait. Maya over in the... Let's get a mic to her, please.
You can go first, sir. Sir,
sorry, I didn't know you had the mic.
Just go for it. Yeah.
Go and then bring it over to Maya.
Bring it over next, I promise. So I saw Jolico, saw you using sky panels. What have you found working really well with the Lightbridge system in terms of your source lights? Like, what are the range of fixtures you like to use?
All of them.
Yeah,
everything. Practicals, light, skylight, big open window.
We've used 100-watt light bulbs that actually exist in scene. We used, I don't know, like a skip from a source that was not even in the room, like anything. I mean, I think you also have to just, before we start saying it as just Lightbridge, applied gear, it's just a tool, right? You know, it's like when you decide to use, you know, your Leico versus your S60, it's the same, you know, concept. You know, it's a tool that you, I found that, you know, when we look through windows and we want to see faces, I thought that a 0 and 1 is something that I use for Lightbridge, right? But, you know, those elements, that you want to create some kind of texture, I don't know, 3 maybe? I don't, it all changes, but, you know, it's per taste, right?
And, you know, basically, you know, it's just 5 diffusions, right? From real mirror replacement to super wide, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the rule of thumb is what goes in comes out plus the level of diffusion. And it's always 100% color consistent, so it means if you take a light bulb, it's going to give you exactly that, just with the level of diffusion added. It's basically that simple.
Well, it's interesting too because one thing to point out is, like, I'm not on projects where I can use 18Ks and 9Ks and big lights. So me, one of the few HMIs I haven't sold yet is the Jolico, because you can put a 5-degree on that, have a 20-centimeter, you know, CRLS panel, 20 feet away, and get a ridiculous amount of output. I mean, it's just like crazy how much output you can get. And we saw that in Manuel; he was using a you know, whereas using a soft light is different. I think, Ted, you mentioned this at some point about you would pick the choice of diffusion relative to what you were trying to do with
it. I mean, I was often running in at the last minute on a close-up or something and trying to figure out how we could just get that last-minute tweak, and no one wanted to wait for me, right? So I would just run in and look at the light I had and pull out. If it was a hard light, I'd go softer. If it was a soft light, I could go harder on the reflection because I knew it already was soft. So I think in some ways, I'm because I'm also the grip in this equation, I was always reacting to whatever I had around me. But once you open your brain to that, I literally would start going, okay, that window's there, and I got that over there, and I can, you can use a lot of different things and the size that you want to use. If it's a window, I'm going to go bigger because there isn't going to be as much, but and bigger and harder,
But you also think about, muslin, too, right? You start thinking about, what you again, you still have to think about what you ultimately want that source to come back as. So if you want it to stay soft, you don't want to go with your harder feeling. So it's like even muslin is still an option, right? Even some other fabric that you might have.
White duvetine, fan of white duvetine. Mm-hmm.
But that being said, so we said the Leco is great. The reason is because you have blades, so you can cut it down to the size of the reflector. That works great. And you see with the Nanlux Spectre, with the, I really like Fresnel still, because you have the chance to say, just if you look at the snap bridge, if you spot it, you're just going to get the reflector, and if you flood it, you're going to get the white with it, with all the other examples we've seen, not with gear. And for example, with the orbiter, with the adapter on it, if you have a 4x4 to one by C100 really far away, you want to have a long throw, it's great to have something on there where you don't lose too much light around the reflector, just so you get as much energy as you can back from it. So there, it's like with everything else, it's the right tool for the right moment, right?
Yeah. And one thing I'll say about the snap bridge, which I only used a little bit, but what I automatically saw was because it's an umbrella, because it's rounded, you don't have to cut as much, because it's gonna focus it more towards the front, and so you don't have to worry about, I just threw up one side or on one, on one side, but the topper and the bottom weren't really necessary.
Maya, you had a question.
Hi, I don't have any questions, but I do want to add a comment. Very fascinating thing for me about light in general is that it reflects. It's kind of like the way we create it is based on where we are in the world. I grew up in Poland, and I went to film school in the UK, and a very popular concept in the UK is to use double bouncing. And after I moved to the US, I've never heard the phrase double bounce again. I grew up watching American movies. Most of them were made in LA. And the way we lit in the UK was very different from the American movies I grew up watching. So in the UK, our primary sources, our key sources were always bounced lights. We'd never use direct lighting because that's just not how the world looks like in the UK. I went to school in a beach town, and I could never really enjoy the beach because there was no direct sunlight almost ever, 3 days during summer. So also just to add that double bouncing was a thing.
Yeah, I mean, kind of just piggybacking off of that, we are, replicating elements of reality. So if that's part of your reality, that's the study, right? We're really implementing some sense of realism, and that's a thing. If it's always cloudy, why would there be a direct light source?
Jakob, are you seeing, as you travel, different parts of the world, Asia, wherever, are you seeing people using these in different ways that you weren't?
Yeah, it's so fascinating. It's amazing how in Asia they more use the harder reflectors and they think so differently about light. So for me, the most exciting thing right now about all these travels is to see how different cultures use the light. And there's two things, right? The environments that we learn from, and then there's the cultural expectancies. How does this show have to look? And it's always balancing these two between how can I do it faster so I actually can add, whatever that Manuel can add Manuel to that, but still it's based upon what needs to be done, and that what sets him apart from a lot of people. And so it's always that's always the play, I think, that we have to work on. What's expected from us, what's our creative input, how can I in my technical world help people get there faster so they can't more time doing their creative things.
But it's interesting that the more Western you go, the more softer it becomes, and the more Eastern you go, the more harder the sources are. But honestly, they have a culture where light's a part of the culture. Just, you know, Appraiser Chaddo's Tanitaki's book. It's just the Asian culture has a bigger awareness of light and its effects than the Western world does. Yeah, that's interesting, yeah.
Anybody else have any thoughts, opinions, comments? Somebody's passing the mic around, right? Okay. Just quick question. I'm curious. Has everybody in here been using CRLS or knows CRLS or had hands on CRLS, more or less? I mean, is there anybody that hasn't yet gone down that path? Okay, great.
Yeah. So, thanks for the talk. It's been amazing. I see that you all are using, or I guess it's usually big sets, but can you talk about using the small ones and like what advantages they may have to character light and then so on and so forth?
Well, we did one scene, we were shooting in a machine shop, and we lit it only with two of the, not the smallest, but the middle small. Forgive me if I don't have my
centimeters. 25 centimeters?
No, smaller than that.
15s.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So I did 15 and then one even smaller.
Oh, sevens.
Okay. Yeah. So because there were two practical lights on either side of the machine. And we had Taylor, who was a woman of a certain age, and then we had a young boy, Edward. And so I used the hard one for Edward and I used the larger soft one for Taylor. But we just literally put them on their back just with a wheel and let the scene play out. And the only other thing we had lit was we tented out the room, the space. So he had a
10K bouncing into a mirror, I think.
Yeah, which was just sort of like raking in. So it gave us the texture of the walls because that was shooting straight down and then bouncing around the space. But the only thing that was really lighting them was the practical itself and the reflection from the practical.
But just kind of answering what you're saying is like you have to remember that just because we're talking about lights, that you know a lamp is not a light source, you know a window is not a light source. So I mean, you know, if you're talking about a smaller set with a smaller budget, just remember that time of day still counts, right? Like if the sun is coming in through that window, you know, maybe that's the time you shoot your scene, right? And you know, if you have a bunch of banks of lights, maybe you turn one side off to create something more, you know, dramatic, right? So you just have to start texturing in your mind when you see these spaces what light is, right? Because everything is a lighting source. Like, don't get so confined by Airy or Nan or whatever the name of the brand is. Not even to be exclusive, because we're lighting every time we look, right? And it's just understanding how we're reducing or adding to what we see in that space. And that's all we do when we scout. You know, it's this space that we say what we're going to reduce or add.
There was just another, there was one other time when I used, I've used the little ones a lot, but I did one special gag where I was doing a commercial and they wanted to have the feeling of traffic, the way that sun bounces off of cars as it moves and it rakes across the ceiling. So what I did was I took, I had gotten this heavy duty Lazy Susan with a Mitchell plate. We were gonna use it for the camera. But what I did was I put a riser on it and then I just filled it with all different sizes, different shapes of, and with magic arms of them in different directions. And then we put a light in it and I just spun it. And so that traveled around the room, and you saw it. Obviously, you know, be bigger and then get smaller as it get less reiki.
And it's being creative sometimes too. Like you know, something about being deficient makes you so much more of a filmmaker. Like because you don't have all the tools and your expectation is so high. Use references. It helps.
It's like Manuel was saying, right? At some point, a piece of paper on the table becomes the light source. So it doesn't matter about the scale, it's just where you take it in your head, no? To say, I don't need all this stuff to make it work.
Yeah, no, you know, I was just thinking, you know, because yes, there were big sets and big things and the quad and everything, it looks all huge and wonderful, but it's not, It's, I mean, go big or go home is not, doesn't mean like really big equipment. It also means just having a big idea or a big solution, simple solution sometimes, to or a radical idea to achieve what you're after. And and it could be something as simple but as radical as telling the AD, hey, we need to shoot this scene between 11 and 1:30 because that's when I have the light coming in, and please, pretty please, and that's it. So you know, it's having a, you know, a big idea more than having the, you know, like big resources oftentimes.
Nicely put, yeah.
And it happens. We'll stop and wait. If Manuel said it, I'm saying it. Yeah.
Can you get a mic over to?
Oh, sorry. Who was it?
Right. I can just shout to
it. It's coming.
It's for the internet.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask: are you guys, or have you guys had a chance to use any of like the quote-unquote hard panels, like Vortex, Sky Panel X, with CRLS? Is that a combination you guys are finding is nice?
Yes, I mean, I use mirrors on everything, so yes.
It's a nice punch. And what's interesting with what I found out when the Vortex came out is the size of the light source does matter. It creates a certain amount of volume. And I used, I did a full show just with Vortexes and with the 100s. And the X is the same thing. It's just, you know, it's just 20 degrees, so how much light do you lose on the sides? And how close do you want to go? Is it like a book light where, it, you know, you're not going to lose anything? Is it further away? It's just balancing it out. But it's, again, it comes back to how much throw do you need? And yeah.
Justyn, what were you saying about using not like actual mirrors or the zero as opposed to a one or a two?
I mean, I use it all the time. Teddy thinks I'm a mad scientist, but I can't see light the same anyway anymore. It's like once you kind of like start playing with these surfaces, your eye trains differently. So I don't know. I could light traditionally, you know, with, because that's how we were trained. But for me, it's just, it's so nuanced now. Like, you know, stacking four or five mirrors on one light can save the whole day, right?
I'm sorry, you said stacking?
Yeah, like, you know, meaning? Have like a, you know, a 4x4, then having another, you know, 2x2, and then, you know, Teddy's drive kit, and
just to redirect
one light.
One light doing multiple.
And this is like, you know, we're talking about the spread of it. Well, we just lean into that curve, and so you start using that one light, and you bring all
because
these different things.
The layering source.
Well, I mean, you still need an ambient light source that hits the ceiling, right? Yeah. You still need to create that, so you use that light source to do the same thing. You still need something to drive into the room, and I always do like a two mirror system where I have the hard mirror and then I have the soft mirror that kind of becomes that like kind of ambient glow.
What's a soft mirror? You mean a soft light into it?
Soft silver.
No, so these are, you know, the reflector boards that have a hard side. So there's a filigreed side and then there's a mirrored side.
Okay.
Or the one that's beat up that looks like someone did not take care of it for years.
Right. What's also
those
nice.
Are coveted
no,
items.
Speaking about something that is messed up. A crack, like a 1x1 cracked mirror. It's really interesting what like the cracking of glass does when it comes back onto the scene. It doesn't work all the time, but it's a unique effect, and it's kind of like a random effect sometimes, which is kind of really, really nice, because it's you can't really recreate that. So
I had one DP who loved that, and so I broke so many mirrors. And the trick with it is, you put gaffer tape on the back of it, and you put J-Lar on the front of it, and then you hit it with your wrench. But
that's true.
But you need to contain it within the tape, otherwise, you know, you got sharp edges. But once you do that, and then we put a pigeon plate on it, and we use it all the time.
It's great.
I really hope there's some special dispensation for cinematic immunity in terms of breaking mirrors. So.
Mike, back over here.
I just wanted to ask, because earlier you were talking about Justyn asking what is real to you, to the DP, and trying to like use that information to sort of inform how you light something, and then Jakob, also you were talking about imitating the DP. in pre-production, before you start choosing your units and like the CRLS and all of that, how does that sort of inform you to communicate with the DP who hasn't maybe isn't familiar with the CRLS, and you know, talking about using those and other units and things that may not align with the DP's previous conceptions of lighting, and you know,
I mean, sometimes it's slowly, right? But I mean, you, the thing that you know you learn just over time in professional life is you have your toolkit too, right? Like you have to bring the things that make you faster too, even though your list is you know based off of what the DP requests, because you know that's what that person, you know, that's part of their toolkit, right? But you know that you always need your stand that goes as low to the ground as you can. You always know you need like a middle ground stand. You know you need a big stand, right? Those are the things that kind of like you, your back pocket things, right? Or whatever you would be your back pocket thing. And you know, it's the to kind of flatten that ground. Usually it's like, you know, the DP would give us references, or we would talk about things that, or watch movies together, or you know, go to a museum or something, or start watching something throughout the episode or throughout the movie, right?
That's where that Slack came in handy for us. Justyn was doing a lot of flying, and we had a plane crash, so he took a lot of video of actual flying, and so that was where you start. You start with a conversation about what quality they want of their light, and what they're looking for it, and then you can then discuss, well, we can do that with these tools.
I mean, look, I think it all comes down to trust. My job as a gaffer is to make sure that a DP can trust me, understand the vision, and I need to make sure I really understand it. I'm not going in there preconceived, I want to use my reflectors. Like, I had a transition period when I was still shooting, and Lightbridge was becoming a name, and I had like DPs really mistrusting me. That guy just wants to sell me something. I said, I'm not bringing this stuff on, I don't care. I'm here to support you to do your thing. And we were shooting like, what was doing downhill. It was really extreme. It took Danny like 2 months in to said, okay, bring me one of those, but I'm not buying them. So there's this thing about trust. And when he started to trust me that I understood where he wanted to go, then it's not about gear anymore. The gear is only in the beginning, if anything, I think a very clumsy communication tool. But it has to be about, do I understand really where that needs to go, and what's the DP comfortable with translating that in which language to me to understand it? And everybody's different. Somebody shows you pictures. Danny hates pictures. He didn't do anything. He just said, put a 5K there, go through a half frame. And that was our way of communicating, which limits me in the beginning. And it's not about ego. It's about saying, okay, I'm just trying to understand where he's going. And as soon as I understand it, then it becomes a flow again. But it's always about following the vision and really embracing it, and then it becomes about the tools.
Yeah, and it, like, for example, it's like, you know, a DP on a commercial when I was in Baltimore said, I want a Xenon, right? And there were no Xenons. So guess what? A mirror came out. You know, so that was one of those moments where it's like how you can, you know, create that gap fast. Because we can't sit around and panic all day, right? We have to be able to create solutions. So that was one of those moments.
I was just wondering, is there a specific situation you could think of where you would prefer to put a big light through a window versus using a reflector? It's like, is there any downsides to that? Like, would you ever choose to do that if for any specific situation?
Because of mirrors and wind, you know, before I, you know, adapted CRLS, yeah. I mean, because it would start shaking as soon as the wind blew.
I mean, it's the same thing again, right? So with diffusion 0 and 1, you shouldn't use in the wind, same problems. Diffusion 2, it's gone. But then again, sometimes it should look like that. Sometimes it should be a 20K through a window because we've got used to the look. I mean, it's really, it's just, again, it's the vision, what's trying to gather. And if you're trying to have a look of the 60s, well, then maybe it's better to use the 20K directly through the window because it's going to give you that. It's not a religion, no way. It's just a tool.
Yeah, and it's the practicality of it all too, right? You know, I'm sure Teddy can go deeper. It's like, you know, sometimes you just don't have the time, right? Because you'll need five, right? When you can just put one 18K out of a window, right? Like, and you actually have the space to make this light look good, right? So why not just put it on a lift and then just put diffusion on it? Sometimes just time and simplicity.
And sometimes the reflector's faster. So it's really, there's no right or wrong there. Yeah.
Anybody else? All right. I guess we will call it a wrap, right?
One more.
It's the last minute, right under the wire.
No, it's great. I'm happy that there's still questions. We didn't put anyone to sleep.
Thank you for all the info. So you're looking at the interview lights up above you. Does that like do chimeras make you cringe?
Oh, Rich!
I want to when Jakob arrived.
That was the first thing Rich Illo told me. He was like, "Please don't judge me because da da da." I was like, "This is what it's supposed to look like." The thing about it is like there's moments where you know we have this understanding of what lighting is, right? Like you go to expos and it's expo lighting. You go to news studios, it's news lighting. Like, I don't think it's like. Right or wrong, but you know there are practices that are in place. Like people use this, like this is an area lighting.
Yeah, well, I would follow up and say to answer your question, a prime example is we often fake news rooms, and so we wouldn't use them for that. We would light.
Yeah, cameras. Yeah, that was yes, a lot of newsrooms.
Jakob did want to light this all with CRLS, but he showed up like late in the day, and we all basically just said, no, it's not happening.
Yeah, and then John said, very correctly, you gotta respect the place we're in. And I said, thank you, sir, for this lesson.
Because Rich was offering to hang all the lights and do all the work, and I'm like, yeah, okay, looks good, that's great.
And Rich is, this is what he does. Like, I'm not even gonna joke, I met Rich doing press junkets for Movie Phone, that's how long we've known each other. So this is it's pretty standard.
And there's a comfort for me there, too, to say it's not a sales pitch. We're trying to share knowledge, and that's what Lightbridge does. And it's not about this is the cool thing, you got to buy this. It's about when does it work, when doesn't it work, and that's the reason it's more important for me. And thank everybody with Lux and Rich and everybody and John doing
helping
out, because it's not about a trade show. Otherwise, I'd have a booth.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, I also want to thank Rich and Samson. I was working at Rich's other stage, and he told me how many jobs he had to turn away for this day. So it takes a real commitment to community and to, you know, gaffers and DPs to say we're holding the space. So, and Lux as well. Lux is, you know, Jason and Mike Baum and these guys have been about community from day one, you know, and doing these kind of events. So.
And the video wall was awesome too. We didn't expect any of that stuff. So thank you, buddy.
Yeah, thank you guys. Really, really fantastic.
Thanks for showing up. I mean, I'm so humbled after 7 years and all of us here now. It's fucking amazing.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
I appreciate you guys. You don't have to leave now. We do have demo units if anyone want to play with some of the CRLS. We're not kicking anybody out. If you want to go to the speakeasy, go to Cream Source, the booth over there. They have a QR code, drinks on Lux. We want to thank... More PA Hire for the wall and everything they support they gave us today. This has been live streamed, and you will be able to find it on Gaffer Salon probably in a couple of days.
No, it's going to be longer, but yeah.
A little longer, but this will be archived, and it will live again, and everyone can watch it, all right? If I can get you guys in front of the screen, we'll take a quick photo.
Sure.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. We appreciate it. We'll start turning on some of the lights if you want to play with it. If you have any questions, you find us. We'll have answers.